Now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
The final episode of Fort Laramie, starring Raymond Burr, October 28, 1956. This episode entitled Army Wife.
At the gallop! Ho!
Fort Laramie, starring Raymond Burr as Captain Lee Quince. Specially transcribed tales of the dark and tragic ground of the wild frontier. The saga of fighting men who rode the rim of empire. And the dramatic story of Lee Quince, Captain of Cavalry.
Are you all right, Jesse?
I'm all right, Major Daggett.
It's been a long walk up here. If you'd like to sit.
I want to stand, thank you.
Jesse, whenever you're ready.
Whenever you're ready, Chaplain. Speak your heart.
He was my friend. Major Thaddeus Hale was, first of all, a friend to all of us here. And we'll miss our friend. Beloved as a man, respected as an officer. Fort Laramie will be a different place without Thad, but a better place for his having served here, lived among us, vigorously and fully for the past 6 years. All of us assembled here at his grave can say of him, he was my friend. All save one. Jesse Hale can say of him, he was my love, my heart. There he lived, and there he will always live. God comfort Jesse. God grant Thad rest and peace and eternal love. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Detail. Ready? Aim. Fire. Ready? Aim. Fire. Ready? Aim. Fire.
Major's flag, ma'am.
Thank you, Sergeant. Thank you, all of you.
Mrs. Hale.
Captain, look at the day. It's a beautiful day. I'm so glad it's a beautiful day.
blasted.
I'm here on the porch, Captain.
It's kind of chilly out tonight, Ms. Hale.
Oh, it seems so close inside. Sit down, won't you?
Thanks. Ms. Hale. Jesse. I'm no hand to put words together well. I can't speak a piece about that.
Don't try, Lee. There's no need.
I liked him, and I'm sorry.
I know. I watched you out on the walk, stopping, starting. You didn't want to come here tonight, and I don't blame you.
It wasn't a question of want. Just, what can a man do? What can he say to a widow except he's sorry?
Sometimes I think it's harder on the friends who are left. Like you say, they want to do so much, say the right things, and there's nothing to do, nothing to say. At least you didn't bake a pie.
I sure never thought of that.
I want you to take some back to old Bedlam. I'll see the rest get to the enlisted men tomorrow. Lee, this minute in my kitchen there are 15 pies and 3 cakes.
Yeah, I guess women always got to bake something at a time like this.
Oh, it's just that people have to do something, and there's nothing to do. Can I talk about Thad?
If you want to.
Oh, I want to. I need to. Every time I start, someone tries to stop me. They think it'll make me sad to talk about him. Good Lord, Lee. Thad and I were happy. It doesn't make me sad to talk about happiness.
You were happy. It showed.
30 years next month. Love and temper in the army. And there wasn't a day of it we didn't live.
You were a lot alike, you and Thad.
We were just alike. Too much, maybe. But we suited each other. When I bellowed, he bellowed back. Good loud time of it we'd have, and then we'd laugh. Then we'd love. I think if I had it to do over, I wouldn't change a thing, Lee. Not even the bellowing.
Well, Thad wouldn't either. I'd bet on that.
Of course he wouldn't. Lee, it was a dirty trick.
The way he died? Yeah.
Lived through every battle from Gettysburg to that skirmish with the Arapaho last month. Cheated smallpox, scarlet fever, scurvy. And the infernal plains weather thrived on all that. And he had to die off duty when lumber pilings fell on him.
One good thing, he never knew it. He'd have been as mad as the devil if he had.
Bellowed his head off.
Man, you'd have bellowed right back.
You bet I would.
Any idea what you're going to do, Jesse?
Live.
Sure.
If you're asking me, do I have a place to go? I have. I have a sister back in Camden. She's alone. We can make a life together. It was my home, Camden, a long time ago.
It'll be a different life in Camden.
Trade my pistol for needlepoint. My saddle for a rocking chair. It'll be very differently.
No rush about your leaving.
Oh, no, thank heaven. Mary Daggett and the Major were over earlier. Said to stay on as long as I liked. Glad they said that. Lee, there's one great favor you can do me.
Anything I can, Jesse.
Take the general.
Thad's mount?
Thad was your kind of army man, and the general's your kind of horse.
Oh, you sit him right well yourself.
But not in Camden, Lee. Maybe sometime, some special time, you'll ride him for Thad and me.
I'd be proud to, Jesse.
October 28, 1956, Fort Laramie on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
You know, a lot of times you have to choose between something high quality or something that saves you money. But if you can get both, why not? Especially when it comes to healthcare. And that's MediShare. You get both. The typical family saves $500 a month switching to MediShare. And that's huge, but it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The customer satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan. Double. It's because MediShare works. It's been around for more than a quarter century, and members have shared more than $3 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge PPO network, so yeah, really, you could save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. If you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now and get a price within 2 minutes. Here is the number you need. Call 833-34-BIBLE. That's 833-34-BIBLE. 833-34-BIBLE.
You're listening to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, and now more of Fort Laramie, starring Raymond Burr, the final show of the series, October 28th, 1956.
Watch it, Lieutenant. He's mean this morning.
Oh, I can not. Sergeant.
Best I give you a hand, sir.
Don't come near. He'll trample you.
Give him his head.
I can't.
You better, Lieutenant, or you're gonna get it. Oh.
Thanks for the warning, Sergeant. You hurt, sir?
That'll come later.
Here. It's been a long time since I've been unseated, Sergeant.
They don't call him the general for nothing. Might be he knows he outranks you, Lieutenant.
I wonder how Major Hale managed him.
I don't know his secret, but he got his way, all right. Now, look at that. The captain's got him mild as a kitten.
Bad spill, Mr. Simons?
I don't think so, Captain. It happened pretty quick.
Oh, he hasn't been ridden for a week. Any new hand would have seemed strange to him.
Yes, sir. Are you going to try him out?
Thought I would. The general and I got to get used to each other. Ms. Hale asked me to care for him.
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. If I'd known that, I wouldn't have tried to ride him. I just thought that he should be ridden.
Oh, if you're all right, there's no harm done. Well, I guess it's my turn to try. But
like I told the lieutenant, Captain, that horse is mean this morning. If it was me, I'd set this one out.
We'll see, Gorse.
You've got the touch all right, sir.
Yeah, but look at them eyes. He's thinking. He's thinking for sure, Captain.
That's how it's done, Sarge.
I just don't trust that horse.
The captain knows what he's doing. He always knows what he's doing.
If I was him, I'd rather know what that horse was thinking. He's got a plan, Lieutenant. The general's got himself a plan.
I'm just not the horseman that Captain Quinn says.
I wouldn't feel too bad about taking that spill.
Just wish it hadn't happened in front of the captain, that's all.
Look out, Captain.
Stick with him, sir. Show him who's boss.
I swear, Captain, if you don't take care, you're going to get the...
Oh, come on, Sergeant. Yeah.
Well, I took your advice, Gores.
How's that, sir?
I set this one out.
Are you all right, sir?
Mm-hmm. Older and wiser, Lieutenant.
I beg pardon?
He's a gift horse. And I looked him square in the mouth.
Oh. Yes, sir.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning, Mrs.
Morning, Jesse.
Oh, Lee. I forgot to tell you one little thing about the general.
Just one little thing, Jesse?
Never try to mount him in the corral.
I guess we can remember that. Wouldn't you say, Lieutenant?
It's a lesson I'll never forget, ma'am.
Go fetch the general, Sergeant. See he's rubbed, fed, and stabled.
Yes, sir.
Oh, not just yet, Sergeant. Just lead him out of the corral and tether him there. I feel like riding this morning, Captain.
Alone, Jesse?
Mm-hmm. Alone. I think both the general and I need work.
Whatever you say, ma'am. Well, if you'll excuse me, Mrs. Hale, Captain, I've got some staff duty to attend to. Mrs. Hale?
Lieutenant?
See you later, Mr. Simons. You making out, Jesse?
Making out? Day at a time, Lee.
Yeah.
I keep discovering things. Just little things every day that help. The cemetery up there, I found out there's nothing of Thad there. I can look, I can go there. Nothing we shared is buried there.
Nothing you shared is buried anywhere, Jesse.
It's a wonderful thing to learn, to know.
Mm-hmm. Got a good morning to ride.
Yeah, crisp and clean. It's a good morning.
Jesse. Jesse, wait.
Major Daggett?
Morning, Major.
Good morning. Jesse, I went over to your quarters. Someone had seen you coming this way.
Doing your own courier duty, Major. I'm impressed.
I wanted to be the one who told you.
I'll leave you to your talk.
No, Lee. Jesse, you'll need your help.
Help?
I wouldn't have had this happen for the world. I had no idea we were in line for any transfers, but... Well, Jesse,
You need my quarters, don't you, Major?
I'm afraid we do.
Well, my, that isn't the end of the world. I didn't expect to stay on indefinitely. How much time can I have?
Well, they're here now, Jesse.
I see.
You can manage makeshift arrangements for a while, can't you, Major?
Mary and I hoped you'd come over with us, Jesse. Stay as long as you like.
Thank you, but no, Major. It's best this way, really. It's time I started my new life.
I'd rather almost anything than this. You know that.
Major, it's the Army. I understand. I will need your help, though, Lee.
You'll have it. Well, go on, Jesse. Take your ride.
Well,
and I... Go on. That's an order, Jesse. You and the General need the work, like you said.
Thanks, Lee. Major?
Some days I hate the Army.
Well, don't let Jesse hear you say that. She's a 30-year soldier.
I never was a hand to collect much. I learned that, moving from post to post. Dad and I could clear out of a place in 2 hours' notice any time.
And did, too, I'll bet.
Oh, you should have seen us when we arrived here from Fort Kearney. 2 rucksacks, 2 saddles, and a pair of silver candlesticks. Only wedding present we had left.
What about all this furniture? It's yours, isn't it?
It was built right here by Thad Stryker and a couple of other enlisted men.
Don't you want any of it, Jesse?
It belongs here.
Well?
I'd feel better knowing it was here, Lee.
Sure. I'll take these bags out.
I'll have the others ready right away.
Now, don't hurry, Jesse, any more than you feel like.
And don't you look so grim, Captain. I mean it. There's a time to go, Lee, a right time. And when it comes, it should happen quickly.
Yeah, that's best.
Oh, I was looking for Mrs. Hale or some name like that.
Her name's Mrs. Hale. She's right inside.
Hello.
Oh, I was under the impression you'd be out of here by now.
Oh, I won't be long. You're Captain Winton's wife?
Jennifer Winton. But all of this quaint furniture, I do hope it's yours, because I certainly wouldn't want to...
It belongs here. It was made here at Fort Laramie.
I can believe that. I mean, it looks so, well, homemade and all.
If you don't want it, Mrs. Winton, have Captain Winton take it up with the adjutant. Furniture's hard to come by out here. Someone can use it.
Oh, now you're thinking I'm rude, and I don't mean to be. You see, we have our own furniture. It's new and quite lovely. I'm sorry, but...
What are you sorry about?
It was just such a shock, seeing all of this furniture. I'm afraid I've not been quite tactful.
You've been quite rude, as a matter of fact. You're very young and spoiled, and I suspect a little foolish.
I beg your pardon?
You needn't. This is your first Army post, Mrs. Winton?
Maybe it is.
My dear, you have a very great deal to learn.
I'm sure I have. But I intend to learn it in my own kind of surroundings.
With your own new, quite lovely furniture.
I intend to make a home here for my husband. The kind of home we're both used to. Just because he's sent out to this desolate corner of nowhere, I don't intend we should live like the rest of the savages.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wish you well, Mrs. Winton.
Thank you, Mrs. Hale.
By the way, where was your home, Mrs. Winton?
Philadelphia.
Oh, that's just across the river from Camden, isn't it?
If you want to put it that way, yes.
I think I do want to put it just that way.
It was shortly after the tapings of Fort Laramie concluded the summer of 1956 that Earl Stanley Gardner said he wanted Perry Mason to be Raymond Burr. Raymond Burr couldn't resist. The problem is the one-hour weekly show took far too much time for him to continue as Captain Lee Quince. Fort Laramie, October 28, 1956, on Classic Radio Theater. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, the conclusion of Fort Laramie, Army Wife. The final episode of the series, October 28, 1956.
Sergeant Gorse took your bags over to the stage. You've still got a few minutes, Jesse.
She can't be over 20. Not a day over 20.
Who can't be a day over 20?
Well, you saw her. She came just as you were taking my bags out.
Oh, that one.
Mrs. Winton. She look over 20 to you?
I'm a better judge of horses, Jesse.
Philadelphia girl. Wonder if I acted like that when I was her age. Camden's just across the river, you know.
Yeah, I remember.
Standing so straight like she was balancing a teacup on her head. Ramrod straight. Of course, in Camden, it was books.
Books?
Mm-hmm.
What was books?
On your head.
Jesse.
Good heavens, Lee, don't be so dense. We were taught to walk that way and sit that way.
With books on your head.
To keep you straight and balance. Of course, mostly it gave you a stiff neck, and I must say it gave you a formidable bearing. Lee.
Hmm?
That girl's scared to death. Why couldn't I see that?
Ms. Winton?
And why wouldn't she be? 20 years in one protected groove, and then she marries and comes out here. Why, she isn't prepared for this life. How could she be?
Nobody much is prepared for this life.
That's exactly what I mean. And they're not going to be as long as complacent old fools like me don't have anything better to say to them than, my dear, you have a very great deal to learn. Lee, is that cottage out by the root house still empty?
I think so, Jesse.
Well, sir, you can move my old furniture in there right away. I'm going to speak to Major Daggett.
You're not going back to Camden?
And be a civilian? Not when there's so much army work to do, Captain. And if I've learned anything in 30 years, the army's taught me. It's time I started paying back a little. And Mrs. Winton's a good place to begin.
That an order, Jesse?
That's an order, Captain. Move out.
Fort Laramie is produced and directed by Norman McDonnell and stars Raymond Burr as Lee Quince, Captain of Cavalry, with Vic Perrin as Sergeant Gorse. The script was specially written for Fort Laramie by Kathleen Height, with sound patterns by Bill James and Ray Kemper. Musical supervision by Amerigo Marino. Featured in the cast were Helen Klebe, Sammy Hill, and Parley Bear. Jack Moyles is Major Daggett, and Harry Bartell is Lieutenant Syberts.
Company, attention! Dismissed.
You've just heard another transcribed story of the Northwest frontier and the troopers who fought under Lee Quince, Captain of Cavalry.
There you have it, the final episode of Fort Laramie, October 28, 1956, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, The Wind-Up, an episode of yours truly, Johnny Dollar Story, the fifth part of the five-part story, The Alvin Summers Matter, from October 28, 1955.
From Hollywood, it's time now for Bob Bailey as...
Johnny Dollar. I told you, that's my name. What do you want, an affidavit?
I've got to be sure.
Look, you've got me out here in the middle of the jungle with a gun in my back.
Don't turn around.
And I can't even see you. You think I'd be kidding you at a time like this?
Any move at all, and it'll be your last.
Tonight and every weekday night, Bob Bailey in the transcribed adventures of the man with the action-packed expense account. America's fabulous freelance insurance investigator.
Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Santo Tomas, Mexico. Expense account submitted by Special Investigator Johnny Dollar. To the Home Office, Northeastern Fidelity and Bonding, Hartford, Connecticut. The following is an account of additional expenses during my investigation of the Alvin Summers embezzlement of $75,000. Item 12, 2 cents. Just what I figured my life was worth at the moment. Gloria Harris had taken me down the beach and into the jungle to show me the hut where Alvin Summers had been hiding out. There was no sign of him. But I heard a noise outside in the underbrush and went out to investigate. I didn't see a thing. But I felt something. A gun barrel pressing against the back of my neck.
I want to talk to you, Dollar.
You've got a quaint way of arranging a conversation, believe me. I could do better if you'd take away that gun.
Johnny!
Don't answer.
Who's answering?
Johnny!
Wait.
Well?
Be in your hotel room in exactly 1 hour.
Look, what's this all about?
You're looking for Alvin Summers, aren't you?
Oh, am I?
Johnny, where are you?
I've got some information about him for you.
Let's have it now.
Not now. I've got to talk to you alone. Be in your hotel room in town in 1 hour, understand?
Look.
Do as I say, and be sure you're alone. Alone.
Okay.
Now, just keep looking straight ahead. Don't turn around, and don't tell anyone about this. Anyone. Understand?
You make it pretty clear.
I'll be watching you, Dollar. You won't see me, but I'll see you.
I can believe it, mister.
Johnny, please. Johnny, where... Oh, here you are.
Yeah, here I am.
Why didn't you answer me?
I came out here looking for a guy, remember? How am I going to find him if I start shouting at you?
But I got worried when you didn't come back to the hut.
Yeah.
That noise you heard outside, did you see anything?
No, I didn't see a thing.
Johnny, didn't you find anything to give you a lead on where Summers might be?
I don't know.
But you said if I helped you find him, you'd see what you could do about getting me a passport back to the States.
Yeah, sure. Come on, let's get out of here.
That suits me fine. This place gives me the creeps, all these trees and vines. Broad daylight, but you can't see a thing.
I know.
My imagination's still working overtime. I've got that feeling we're being watched again. Funny, isn't it?
Yeah, real funny. We kept on toward the beach. Gloria was fidgeting because she thought somebody was watching us. I was fidgeting because I knew somebody was. And I had a strong hunch he was the man whose long-distance phone call to the States brought me down to Mexico in the first place. We got back to the beach. I took Gloria up to her hotel and went down to mine in town. As I crossed the lobby toward the stairway to the second floor, out popped a familiar face.
Hello, friend.
Oh, Carson. Lieutenant Gomez let you out of jail, huh?
Oh, now let's get one thing straight, friend. I never was actually in jail.
Well, you're lucky. I've seen the jail.
Huh? Oh, well, I just had to pay a fine, and that judge they got in this burg read me the riot act, but then they let me go.
Well, good. So now it's back to selling zippers, huh?
Sure is. And I'm behind schedule, too. Checking out right now, as a matter of fact. A lot of territory to cover. Like I always say, half the world's
waiting to get zipped up. Yeah, you told me.
I did. Say, Dollar,
mm.
I'd like you to do me a favor.
Oh?
That little trouble I got into last night up at the Playa del Mar Hotel, I'd sure appreciate it if you'd keep quiet about it when you get back to the States.
You mean you don't want anybody to know you got plastered, grabbed a serape, and did the fandango?
No, Dollar.
Broke a guitar over the musician's head?
Now, can't we just forget about that?
Believe me, I had until you reminded me. Now, Carson, I'm reasonably sure we don't know the same people and won't be seeing each other again. I'd say the secret of your lurid past was pretty safe.
Well, I sure hope so, friend. But about not seeing each other in the States, I was planning on looking you up.
Goody.
Yes, sir, I got a deal for you.
Sorry, but I have all the zippers I can use at the moment.
No, that's not what I mean, friend. I've been trying to get you into a cribbage game, remember?
How can I forget?
Well, instead, I'm going to look you up in the States and let you teach me to play gin rummy.
How could I be so lucky? Oh, sorry, I think that's my phone. So long, Carson.
I'll sure look you up back in the good old USA, friend.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Keep your hands on the table.
What? Oh, my shadow again.
Anybody follow you?
Not that I know of. You're early.
I know. And I searched your room.
That's become an old Santo Tomas custom.
To make sure you really were Johnny Dollar.
So now you know. What about it?
You can turn around.
I don't know. Maybe you'll tell me what... Wait a minute. A decent shave and you'd match that photo I have in my suitcase. Alvin Summers.
Yeah. I'm Alvin Summers.
I don't get it. I had you figured for the man who made that long-distance call to the States that tipped me off to come down here.
You're right about that, too.
You put the finger on yourself?
If you want to call it that.
Well, what happened? Your deal go sour on you, maybe?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, sit down. Take it easy. Tell me about it. I'll turn on the overhead fan. Pretty stuffy in here.
Dollar, that phone call you got just now...
Hung up. Clerk downstairs must have rung the wrong room.
Or somebody was checking to see if you were here.
Could be. Okay, suppose you start from the top.
What was that?
Relax.
What are you...
Just one of the charming features of this room.
Why?
You turn on that big overhead fan, it slams the balcony door.
Oh, well, turn it off, will you? I'm kind of edgy.
Yeah, sure.
You asked me if my deal had gone sour. It went very sour. Oh, I had it all figured out. I was planning it for a year. I was going to embezzle the $75,000 and really live big.
Yeah.
Instead of that, I spent all my time hiding. Mexico City, Cuernavaca, Tampico, you name it, I was there. Always undercover, always hiding. Did you ever spend much time hiding, Dollar?
No, not much.
Oh, it's a great life, great. Every time somebody looks at you on the street, you're sure he's after you, tailing you. You wake up in the middle of the night, you see a shadow outside. It turns out to be just a bush, but you spend the rest of the night sweating. Finally, I just couldn't take it anymore. The rest of my life that way.
You know, Summers, a lot of guys figure that out before it's too late. Too bad you didn't.
Yeah. So, finally, I phoned the bonding company long distance. I knew they'd send an investigator. They sent you. I thought if I could talk to someone like you, see what could be done.
There's only one thing can be done at this point, Summers. Come back with me to the States. Bring back what's left of the money.
$60,000.
That'll help. But you know there can't be any deal.
Yeah, I guess I always knew that. Here, take the gun.
Thanks. Now, what about the money?
It's in a safe deposit box in Mexico City. Here. Here's the key.
One thing I don't get, though, Summers.
Yeah?
You wanted me to contact, but you were sure playing hard to find.
Well, I had to be careful. I got a look at you the first day you arrived. I wasn't sure you were the one, so I decided to come to your room that night, but then I saw somebody else coming here, so I gave up.
Who was it?
The bellboy.
Benito? Hey... That'd be just before he got knifed.
Oh, no. I wasn't the one who killed him, Dollar. I'm no killer. Just the fool who runs away with somebody else's money, remember? Anyway, I didn't have another chance to get to you till today. I had to keep undercover so they wouldn't find me.
Wait a minute. Who's they?
The man who arranged for me to come down here and the girl who was going to make it all worthwhile.
The girl? Summers,
leave
don't...
me, Johnny.
Gloria.
Hello, baby. Here, let me...
Leave the gun right where it is, Johnny. Put that safe deposit key on the table.
I guess you're calling them.
Thanks.
And it all adds up. You found out Summers here was planning to turn himself in. You didn't want that money to slip through your fingers. But Summers disappeared from his hideout. You couldn't find him, so you figured you'd let me find him for you.
That's right. And it worked. And you're so right about that money. You think I'd give it up now?
Gloria.
Keep out of it, Alvin. If you want to go back and be a Boy Scout, that's your business. The money stays with me. Johnny.
Yeah?
This doesn't have to be the end of it for us.
Oh. So now we get the pitch about making beautiful music, huh?
I'm not kidding, Johnny. $60,000's a lot of money.
You know, you put on quite an act. Maybe I believed a little bit of it. But if I did, I quit the moment you walked through that door just now.
Okay, Johnny, that's enough. I thought maybe you'd be smart, but if you won't, you'll leave me no choice.
No, Gloria, don't. Gloria! The balcony. Out on the balcony.
Hold it!
Carson.
Stay right where you are, friend.
Oh, shut up. She's dead.
She crossed me.
You and she were working against each other. She wanted me to lead her to Summers. You wanted to find him yourself.
That's right. And Summers, you took a lot of finding.
That's why you killed Benito the bellboy to shut his mouth. Then you went up to the big hotel and clowned around so you'd get arrested and that way set up an alibi for the evening.
I was pretty proud of that little idea, Dollar. And it's all worked out just the way I wanted it. You see, right from the start, I...
Carson was holding all the trumps. They were made out of lead, and I knew he was going to start dealing them any second. Then I remembered the overhead fan. The switch was right next to my elbow. The balcony door was open, and Carson had his back to it.
What are you doing?
Just turning on the fan. I need some air. Can you blame me?
Yeah. You're sweating, aren't you, Dollar? What's the matter? You losing your nerve? Well, it really doesn't matter. What the...
The door slammed. Carlson whirled. And I knocked the lamp off the table. By the time I hit the floor, my gun was out. I picked up the lamp and lit it again. Summers was crouched in a corner. Across the room, sitting on the floor, was Carson staring stupidly down at the red bullet hole in his side. I picked his gun up off the floor.
Dollar!
Summers, call the police station, Lieutenant Gomez.
Yeah, all right.
Help me, Dollar.
Yeah, it hurts. But not as much as it hurt Benito and Gloria.
I...
You finally got me into a game, didn't you, friend? And you lost. Expense account item 13. Double the amount of item 1. $440. Transportation back to the States for Alvin Summers and me. And you know, I turned him over to the authorities as soon as we got back. That's the way he wanted it. Gloria? Well... Once in a while, I get to wondering if she really meant some of the things she told me. Not that it matters. Conclusion of report. Expense account total $923. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Remember, please, there'll be a new exciting story on Johnny Dollar beginning next Monday.
Next week, the Valentine matter. And believe me, it's not the kind of Valentine you'd wish on even your worst enemy. Join us, won't you? Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Yours truly, Johnny Dollar, starring Bob Bailey, is transcribed in Hollywood, written by Robert Reif. It is produced and directed by Jack Johnstone. Heard in this week's cast were Virginia Gregg, Marvin Miller, Don Diamond, Tony Barrett, and Parley Bear. Be sure to join us on Monday night, same time and station, for another exciting story of Yours Truly, Johnny Dollar. Roy Rowan speaking. We'll be right back.
October 28th, 1955, yours truly, Johnny Dollar, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. And you got to recognize Parley Bear there as Alvin Summers. That was a very familiar voice in old-time radio. We thank you so much for joining us. Hope you'll visit our webpage, classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. Stream our shows on demand. Learn more about classic radio collecting. You can also find lists of sites where shows are available for download. You can also find our social media links. You can also contact me, and if you're so inclined, you can buy me a coffee. Now, that buy me a coffee money does not buy coffee, because I don't drink coffee. But what we do is we're here, we use that buy me a coffee money to help us acquire additional classic radio collections for us to bring you here. That's at classicradio.stream, classicradio.stream. Thanks for tuning in. Please thank this station, support their advertisers, tell your friends the great radio shows are right here at this spot on the dial. Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on your favorite radio stations.